Jayo Kunja Bihari. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rambu, Hare Rambu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ramu, Hare Ramu, Ramu Ramu, Hare Hare. Jayo Radha Madhav, Jayo Radha Madhav, Radha Madhav, Jayo Radha Madhav. Jayo Panchatattva, 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 Jayo Panchatattva, Jayo Panchatattva, Panchatattva, Jayo Panchatattva. Nrsimha Dev, Nrsimha Dev, Nrsimha Dev, Jayo Jaya Nrsimha Dev. Jaya Prabhupada, 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 Shila Prabhupada. Prabhupada, 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 Prabhupada. Prabhupada, 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 Prabhupada. Shri Shri Radhamadavasta Saki Ki Jai, Shri Panchatattva Ki Jai, Shri Nrsimha De Bhagavana Ki Jai, Shila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jaya Vishnupad Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Shukara Shota Shri Srimad His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada Ki Jai. Jaya Vishnupadaya Paramahamsa Parivrajakacharya Shota Shota Shri Srimad Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Maharaja Ki Jai Prabhupada. Nanda Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Namacharya Shila Haridas Thakur Ki Jai. Prem Sekago Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadata Shri Vasadi Gora Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. Shri Shri Radha Krishna Gopa Gopinath Shyamakund Radha Kund Giri Govardhana Ki Jai. Vrindavan Dham Ki Jai. Mayap Mathura Dham Ki Jai. Navadvip Dham Ki Jai. Jagannath Puri Dham Ki Jai. Ganga Mai Ki Jai. Yamuna Mai Ki Jai. Tussi Devi Ki Jai. Bhakti Devi Ki Jai. Sankitan Yagya Ki Jai. Brihad Mridanga Ki Jai. Samaveta Bhaktavrinda Ki Jai. Gaura Premanande Hari Hari Bol. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to assembled devotees. All glories to Shri Shri Guru Granga. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Today we are reading from Canto number 10, chapter 2, text 22, Srimad Bhagavatam. Sa esham jitan kalu samparito varteta yo tyanta nishamshitena dehe mritte tam manuja Shapanti Ganta Tamo Nidam Tanu Manino Dhruvam Saisha Jitvam Kalu Samprato Saisha Jivam Kalu Samprato Varteta yo tyanta nishamshitena Varteta yo tyanta nishamshitena Dehe mittetam manujaksha panti Dehe mittetam manujaksha panti Ganta tamo nidam tanu manino dhruvam Ganta tamo nidam tanu manino dhruvam Saesha jivan kalu sampareto Varteta yo tyanta nishamshitena Dehe mrittetam manujakshapanti gantatamani dam tanumani no dhruvam. Gantata monidam tanumani no dhruvam. Saesha jivan kalu sambareto. Varteta yo tvantanchitena. Dehemiteta manuja shapanti. Gandata monidam tanumani no dhruvam. Matadis. Varteta yatva danisham shitena. Dehemitetam manuja chapanti. Gantata monidam tanu manino dhruvam. Sangisha jivan kalu sampareto. Vateta yat vanjanisham hasitena. Dehe mitetam manuja shampanti. Gantata monidam tanu manino dhruvam. Matajis. Saesha jivan kalu sampareto. Sa, he, esha, that jealous person, jivan, while living, kalu, even, sampareta, is dead, varteta, continues to live, yah, anyone who, atyanta, very much. Nisham shitena, by executing cruel activities. Dehe, when the body. Mrite, is finished. Tam, him. Manuja, all human beings. Shampanti, condemned. Ganta, he will go, tamahandam, to hellish life. Tanumanina, of a person in the bodily concept of life. Dhruvam, without a doubt. Translation. A person who is very cruel is regarded as dead even while living. For while he's living, or after he's dead, everyone condemns him. And after the death of a person in the bodily concept of life, he is undoubtedly transferred to the hell known as Antama. Purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada Ki Jai. Kamsa considered that if he kill his sister while living, he will be he would be condemned by everyone, and after that he will go to the darkest region of hellish life because of his cruelty. It is said that a cruel person, like a butcher, is advised not to live and not to die. While living, a cruel person creates a hellish condition for his next birth, and therefore he should not live. But he is also advised not to die, because after death he must go to the darkest region of hell. Thus, in either circumstance, he is condemned. Kamsa, therefore, having good sense about the signs of the soul's transmigration, deliberately refrained from killing Devaki. In this verse, the words Gantatamo Nidam Tanu Manino Dhruvam are very important and require extensive understanding. Srila Jiva Goswami, in his Vaishnava Toshani Tika, says Tatra Tanu Maninam Papina Iti Dehatma Budhaiva Papa Binivesho Bhavati. One who lives in the bodily concept, thinking, I am this body, involves himself by the very nature of this concept, conception, in a life of sinful activities. Anyone living in such conception is so to be considered a candidate for hell. Ananda Gobir Vishvatam Tamishram Puna Punash Chavita Charvananam. Bhagavad 7:5:30. One who is in the bodily concept of life, he has no control over sense gratification. Such a person can do anything sinful, to eat, drink, be merry, and enjoy a life of sense gratification, not knowing of the soul's transmigration from one body to another. Such a person does whatever he likes, whatever he imagines, and therefore, being subject to the laws of nature, he suffers miserably again and again in different material bodies. Javat kriyashtavat idam manobai karmatmakam yena sharira badam. Bhagavatam 5:5:5. In the bodily concept of life, a person is karmanubandha, or conditioned by karma. And as long as the mind is absorbed in karma, one must accept material body. Sharira bandha, bondage of the material body, is a source of misery, or keshado. Na sadhu manyat jata atmanoyam asam api keshada asya deha. Although the body is temporary, it always gives one trouble in many ways. But human civilization is now unfortunately based on tanumani, the bodily concept of life, by which one thinks, I belong to this nation, I belong to this group, I belong to that group, and so on. Each of us has his own ideas, and we are becoming increasingly involved individually, socially, communally, and nationally in the complexities of karmanubandha, or sinful activities. For the maintenance of the body, men are killing so many other bodies and becoming implicated in karmanubandha. Therefore, Srila Jiva Goswami says that tanumani, those in the bodily concept of life, are papi, sinful persons. For such sinful persons, the ultimate destination is the darkest region of hellish life, gantatamo nidam. In particular, a person who wants to maintain his body by killing animals is most sinful and cannot understand the value of spiritual life. In Bhagavad Gita 16:19-20, the Lord says, Tan aham dvishatam kuran samareshu naradaman krishapanu ajasram ashubam ashurshvi eva jomishu ashurim yomin apanganam manmuda janmani mam apraprayiva kanteya tatojanu adamamangatim. Those who are envious and mischievous, who are the lowest amongst men, are cast by me into the ocean of material existence, into various demoniac species of life. Attaining repeated birth among the species of demoniac life, such persons can never approach me. Gradually, they sink down to the most abominable type of existence. A human being is meant to understand the value of human life, which is a bone obtained after many, many births. Therefore, one must free oneself from Tanuman, the bodily concept of life, and realize the Supreme Personality of Godhead. One more time, verse. A person who is very cruel is regarded as dead even while living. For while he is living or after he is dead, everyone condemns him. And therefore, and after the death of a person in the bodily concept of life, he is undoubtedly transferred to the hell known as Andhattama. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishta Bhutale Shimate Jata Swami Niti Namine. Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishta Bhutale Shimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Niti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pacharne Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadata Shivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda. Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. Vanchakalpaturbhyascha kripa sindhupya eva cha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo nama namaha. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. So this is a very, very interesting and deep verse, deep text. And Srila Prabhupada obviously was very inspired since he gives such a long purport. And he also felt that we have to go deeper into the topic and to understand why it's so important to avoid any sinful activities. Why it's important for us, why it's important for everyone around us, and why in generally we have to follow the Sanatana Dharma properly. So today we will discuss about a few different topics. We will try to answer on a few different questions. Question number one is, what is happening with those who are cruel? And not just cruel, but actually with those who are very serious in their attempt to maintain material activities. Then number two is, sometimes cruel people or greedy people or meat eaters or those who are materially successful but they don't have even drop of spiritual life, they have a lot of opulence, a lot of properties, a lot of power. And many times happen that devotees are not in that situation. They don't have much. Many times they're struggling and everything. So we'll try to answer and question, why is that? Why is actually the whole system made like that by Krishna, by the Lord? But question number three is, can we understand everything? All knowledge, everything given in Shastras, everything given in Prabhupada books even, can we understand really everything? Can we go so deep into analyzing everything and understand on that platform of intelligence to be able to state, okay, I know everything, I understand that. So that's the question number three. Then question number four, what is really the biggest treasure in the world? And who can really possess it? And number five, how we should accept and honor message of spiritual master. So I'll try to put all these different questions into one flow together, and we don't have much time, so I need to go further into that. First things first, we should go back to the text and actually in particular situation that Kamsa, he's considering of killing his sister Devaki. She's pregnant, she's in prison, but the point is that in one moment he decides not to do that. He's considering. Why? So in the previous verse, yesterday you heard that first he was thinking, okay, if I do that, then in this life, I will have a big problems. I will lose my power. I will lose my opulences, because one of the biggest offenses you can do is actually to kill a woman. You heard yesterday, it's not just a woman. It's also the old man, the children. So the point is that's first thing which is not good for him in that particular situation. And the second one is, which is even worse than that, because, you know, lifetime is limited, but after life, in that case, he will go to hell. He will go in the darkest part of hell. And that's not really matching his equation of being powerful, successful, having a lot of opulence, having a lot of power. So basically the reason why he decided not to kill Devaki is not really because she's his sister, because his compassion, his humility. No, he decided because of selfish interest. He decided because he didn't want to lose what he has. Actually, he wanted to gain even more. He wanted to gain even more by killing Krishna. So the point is here that sometime outside reaction can be similar, but we cannot just look into actions of personalities around us. We need to see the motivation as well. Once we see their motivation, then we will understand really are they advanced or not, where they belong in that line of human society, right? Which kind of human being they are. So let's go to the first question. What is happening with those who are cruel? It's not just cruel, it's also who are going very serious about their material existence, about, you know, putting together around, it doesn't matter how, just to have a lot of properties, to have a lot of power, to have a lot of political gain, to have a lot of different kind of opulences, material opulences, which this world offers. Well, it's clearly stated, and not just in this place, in Srimad Bhagavatam, but in other places as well, with that those personalities who are really deepest in their desire and who will do whatever, it doesn't matter what, just to gain that, definitely after this life, after they leave their bodies, they will go to hell. They will go to the darkest parts of hell. So the cruelty quite often goes also with another characteristic of the personality, selfishness. I mean, those who are cruel, they're doing because they want to gain something for themselves. Therefore, they are selfish. Then another is enviousness. Those who are cruel, they always want to be best of the best. It doesn't matter what they're doing. It doesn't matter which goal, which mountain they try to occupy, to achieve. You know, they want to be better than anybody else around them. And that's a reflection of another quality. That means that they're envious. They cannot stand. Their false ego cannot stand to have anything around them, not even close. Which was situation with Kamsa also. He's not only one in Vedic literature that we know. They want to be best of the best. They want to have the, you know, the biggest power, the biggest amount of treasures, everything. I mean, actually, that idea is in the mind of many people, especially in the Kali Yuga. And this is actually that seed which can bring us on really wrong path. And it can end up in some places that really we don't want to go there. It's really better. It's dark, a lot of fire, a lot of creatures. You know, it's unlimited. It takes very long time to be there to learn the lesson. It's a very hard place to be. So that's why we have to be very careful, even when we see just that root is growing in our mind, just a small seed. We need to take it out and to clean our garden of mind. What does it mean and how to do that? We will discuss about that, but I'm just going to mention especially, you know, those characteristics like cruel, selfish, envious. We have to do exactly reverse, exactly opposite. And what are characteristics which are opposite to that? We have to be very merciful. We have to be very humble. We have to share with everybody everything. We don't want to any possessions to ourselves. We want all the best to all other human beings. All other beings, not just human beings, animals as well. That's why the first step when somebody wants to become successful is actually to stop eating animals. You know, because that's one of the biggest cruelties. So therefore, did you ever saw humble man, like really seriously humble person who is very cruel? Did you ever saw that in your life? Somebody who is very humble and nice and decent and wow, he's so cruel, it's amazing. No, those two things doesn't go together. That's why on the very conscious level, we should not wait these things to happen to us. On a very conscious level, we have to work very hard on that. So now if somebody is cruel, if somebody possesses bad characteristics, it doesn't matter which cloth they're wearing. They have that. In Bhakti Sandarbha, Jiva Goswami, he mentioned that many of such personalities who pretend to be devotees also, they can criticize sadhu, acharyas, shastras even, gurus. And we have to be very careful of that. He actually mentioned, he wrote there that person in that state of mind can offer a perfect dandavat, can dress really well, can spoke really nice. But the point is that if he doesn't maintain the bhakti inside of his heart, if he maintains some other motivation to be amongst devotees, then he cannot be considered as devotee. And he needs to be helped, or he needs to be careful that we don't stay close to that association. So it's not just that we're talking about the biggest demons of this world, those butchers and I don't know what. We're talking about reality. Everywhere, wherever we turn around, we need to be careful about those things. First, what we have to be careful is our mind. Second is around close surrounding, then bigger surrounding. And one of those surroundings is internet as well. through internet you can get a lot of... You know how a person becomes cruel? It becomes cruel in such a way that receiving a lot of informations, and then mind start telling, I want this, I want that. If we don't stop that in time, that will grow into such a serious desire that it's going to be very hard to take out from our mind. So we need to deal on beginning. Now, second question is that, many times devotees are discussing, I'm really serious in spiritual life and especially kastas, right? And I don't know what is happening. I'm trying and Krishna is not giving me. Krishna is not giving, my neighbor, he's meat eater and he's this and he's that. And he has a nice company and making big money and successful and he has a good Mercedes Benz and has everything else. And me? Nothing. I try many things. I did many things. It's just not happening in my life to put a life together, to do, and I'm really trying. Or, sometime in the later episode of our life, it happens that we start losing everything slowly, naturally, gradually. Why is that happening? It's very important, devotees, to understand that, because sooner or later, each one of us comes to that situation. Even if we are not in Grihastha Ashram, it comes to that situation, that we don't gain power, we don't gain fame, we don't gain, material possessions. That's because Krishna loves us. That's because Krishna cares about us. In Srimad Bhagavatam 10.88.8, Krishna said, Shri Bhagavan Ujvacha Vashyam Anugrani Harishyatad Dhanam Shani Tato Dhananam Tyasyanta Asya Svajana Dukkha Dukitam. The personality of Godhead said, if I especially favor someone, I gradually deprive him of his wealth. Then the relatives and friends of such poverty-stricken man abandon him. In this way, he suffers one distress after another. So basically, if Krishna really put his attention to someone, if Krishna really loves someone, he gradually wants to help him and he starts taking away from him everything. And of course, when you're not successful, you don't make money, you don't have power, you don't have place to stay, of course, friends and relatives start abandoning you. They don't want to be with such a person because he is not provider anymore. And of course, that's a disturbance on certain level, but it's a huge blessing on much higher level than that. And this is what we have to understand on time, because if we don't understand that and we are already 50, 60, 70, and these trembles start happening, we're going to have a trouble of understanding really what's going on. So from purport of this verse, of this text from Srila Prabhupada, he said, if the Lord is so compassionate to his devotees, why does he expose them to specific suffering? This is answered by analogy. A very affectionate father takes the responsibility of restricting his children's play and making them go to school. He knows that this is a genius expression of his love for them, even if the children fail to understand. Similarly, the Supreme Lord Vishnu is mercifully strict with all his dependents, not only with immature devotees struggling to become qualified. Even perfect saints like Prahlad, Dhruva, and Yudhishthir were subject to great tribulation, all for their glorification. So it's not only us. even the highest level of devotees, they go through the same process. But they understand, wow, I'm getting the special mercy of the Lord right now. It's right for me to just to proceed with that and to learn and to go further. So the second question is when Vaishnavas are happy or distressed, is it the same kind of karma like for those who are non-devotees? And the answer is no. Again, Srila Prabhupada explains that those are two completely different kinds of karmas, let's say. We cannot even call it karma for devotees. Material happiness and distress arising from karma leave a subtle residue, the seed of future entanglement. Such enjoyment and suffering tend towards degradation and increase the danger of falling into hellish oblivion. Happiness and distress generated for the Supreme Lord desires, however, leave no trace after their immediate purpose has been served. Moreover, the Vaishnava who enjoys such reciprocation with the Lord is in no danger at all of falling down into nisance. As Yamaraj, the Lord of the dead and the judge of all departed souls, declares, Yamaraj is saying, my dear servants, please bring to me only those sinful persons who do not use their tongues to chant the holy name and qualify in qualities of Krishna, whose heart do not remember the lotus feet of Krishna even once, and whose heads do not bow down even once before Lord Krishna. Send me those who do not perform their duties towards Vishnu, which are the only duties of human life. Please bring me all such fools and rascals. So it's serious. It's not a joke at all. And even on material level, sometime if we feel that we are struggling, that we don't have enough, that we don't maintain ourselves or our families properly, it doesn't mean that we are not on the right path. It doesn't mean that Krishna really doesn't care about us. As a matter of fact, he's saying, those that I especially love, I take from them. Gradually. That's important word. It's not that just cut, take everything and go. No, gradually. Like I hear many times devotees, you know, they're like 30, 35, and they, you know, they struggle in grihastha life. Okay, I'm going to cut everything. I'm going to become an aprastha, then sannyasi, then whatever is after sannyasi. You know, and that's it. I'm going. No, it doesn't happen like that. It should happen gradually. Very important. That's a mode of goodness. So now the question which I really wanted to point out today, and that's, can we understand everything? And if not, how? Why? Why is it happening like that? I just came back a few days ago from Europe, when I spent almost 2 months with my family, and we was traveling, visiting different festivals, different yatras. We traveled to 7-8 countries, spent times with friends and with senior devotees. And I noticed one thing that there is a lot of preaching happening, it's beautiful, it's nice, but sometimes devotees, they spend, especially those who are not senior by, I'm not talking about Srila Prabhupada disciples, but senior means they're already 15, 20, 25 years in the moment. They have tendency to gain more and more knowledge, but not anymore on the level of faith and gratitude, but on level of trying to satisfy their intelligence and trying to go deeper into understanding really on material way even, why it's happening, what is happening. And they started discussing about that. And they told me, I was surprised, obviously we spent a lot of time here, so we're a little bit, let's say, secure here in Mayapur, you know. But they're discussing, they have a lot of forums, a lot of Facebook pages, a lot of different places where they discuss about so many different topics. And they go deeper and it's, sometimes you hear many nice things, but sometimes it's going into confusion even. So maybe two personalities, they understand what they're talking about, but another 10 who are reading that, they're completely confused. So why is that happening? I will not go into whether that's good or not. I mean, obviously, it's good since it's happening, but why we cannot understand everything? That's the question which really occurred to my mind. So the point is that first, I will share one story with you, and probably many of you heard about that story, but it's always good that we remind ourselves again. There was a frog, you know, the black, gray, froggish frog. She was living in one well, and well was about this diameter, and well was full of water all the time. There was one small stone island there, and a lot of insects also were coming, so that frog has what to eat there, and she was walking around that well left and right, but she could not climb up because she was too small and there was not so much rocks. If it was a bigger frog, maybe it could come out, but it was not possible for her. So she was living her happy life, and she was always telling, okay, it's good that I'm here, probably there's nothing around outside anyway, and actually I got a special mercy to live in my wealth with my insects and everything else. And her serenity, her happiness in one moment, in one day, got disturbed by another frog jumping into well. It was a big green frog, and it was kind of different than the great frog. And somehow that frog entered to that well, and we're gonna hear the rest of the story later. So the small frog was coming and saw that frog and saw that she's different, she's lighter and she's bigger. She was asking, "Who are you, stranger?" And she said, "I am the frog." She said, "So there is more than one frog in this world?" And this other frog said, "Yeah, there is more frogs around." She said, "So from where you're coming?" And the other frog said, "Well, I'm coming from, there is a place where the big river meets the ocean. So it's a huge water there, and I'm living there with another frogs. And accidentally, I was walking and I just jumped into this well." And she said, "What is the ocean?" And the big frog said, "Well, the ocean, river, or there are big waters." He said, that water you're talking about, is it bigger than my wealth?" And this other frog said, "Yeah, it's bigger." And the small frog was, "How much bigger? Is it like two my wealths? Three?" And the big frog said, "No, I mean it's much, much, much bigger than that. You should go to see." And then the first frog was thinking, "Oh, I should go to see that big water and another thing." And then in one moment, mind start ticking, tick, tick, and then frog start closing her eyes and watching that green frog and thinking, "Oh, I know now. This green frog actually came to take over my wealth. She want me to live and she want to take over my treasure, my power, my big place, and you know, she doesn't want me here anymore. That's why she want me to go up, out, and I will never come back. And I will die there. There is nothing there actually. I know that." And then she starts closing towards the big green frog and telling, "Get away. Go away right now. Go away. Go away." And the big frog was confused, and then somehow she jumped and disappeared. And actually, you know, many times our lives we consider like that well. You know, we have situations, we have chances in the life. Chances are coming and going and coming and going. And it's up to us It's not up to Krishna. It's not up to anybody else whether we are going to take it or not. Whether we are going to accept somebody or something in our life really, truly from our heart, or to us that person or that situation, whatever, just to leave that mercy of the Lord. We are only one who is deciding. And that depends very much on the stage of our consciousness and that particular moment when situation is happening. We don't know when situation will happen. That's why we have to be prepared and ready all the time. Our consciousness has to be on high level all the time. Not, okay, now it's weekend, let me relax a little bit. Maybe I don't need to chant 16 rounds, or I will chant later, or let me just do this or that. Go for Calcutta weekend shopping or something. I'm not saying that devotees should not go, but the point is that motivation should be right. So look, it's very important in which stage of consciousness we are. Now, there is another wealth. There is another wealth that we all wish to be. There is the right wealth for devotees, not just for devotees, for everybody in this world. It's mentioned in one of the books. Do you anybody remembers which wealth we're talking about here? Which wealth is mentioned that every devotee should take part of? And what is the name of that wealth? I will just give you a hint. Srila Narottam Das Thakur wrote a book named Prema Bhakti Chandika, right? In that book he explains that there is the wealth, a very special wealth. Anybody knows what is the name of that wealth? It's a short name. The wealth name is Rasa Rupa. Rasa Rupa wealth. He was mentioning in the book that there is the wealth of nectar, of pure, sweet nectar in the middle of Vrindavan. And not just Vrindavan, anybody, anywhere can jump into that nectar. He was telling the name is Rasa Rupa. That nectar is made of the teachings of Rupa and Sanatana Goswami. Something that even Srila Prabhupada was using a lot of his books and everything else. The name is Rasa Rupa. Rasa means sweetest and Rupa means wealth. Sorry, it's not Rupa, it's Kupa. Kupa. Kupa means wealth. Well, right? Like place where we can just jump and have the all this nectar. And he's saying that although in Vrindavan, most of this well, they have quite, you know, salty water. They have that bitter, salty taste. That wealth is very, very sweet. It's beautiful. It's full of nectar. And any devotee should take a shelter of that wealth. Basically, we have to leave our well and go to that well and jump inside. That's a beautiful thing. Okay, now we should talk about what is the biggest treasure of this world and who can achieve it, really. What is the biggest property we can gain in this world? First, I want to ask you a question. What is the biggest material treasure of this world? I mean, for many centuries, many people are trying to find that. They were looking around the world, they were looking into the books, they were researching, trying to get it. What is... Sorry? Okay, that's also very valuable. But there is one thing... Sorry? Yes, that's also very valuable material possession, but did you hear about the touchstone or philosopher's stone, those who like Harry Potter? Yeah, I mean, touchstone is basically like having your own desire tree in material world. You have a touchstone, you can turn everything into gold, you can fulfill all your desires and everything else. So the many, many, even, you know, people who doesn't have anything to do with religion, they were going and trying to find the touchstone. And this is count as one of the biggest, maybe even the biggest material opulence you can have in your life. Somebody can have in his life. But what is interesting thing, I found out doing this research that actually in one particular moment, that touchstone could end up in West Bengal. And I will explain you how and why. And also the Death Touch Stone is, even today, is one particular place. And it's explained in one story. So once there was a very poor devotee of Shiva, whose name, according to Bhakta Mala and Gaudiya Vaishnava Bidana, was Sri Jivan Chakravarti. Sri Jivan Chakravarti is originally from Manakar. Manakar, this is in the Burdwan district. There is one village named Manakar. I don't know if you heard about that, right? So Chakravarti was from Manakar, and he was the great devotee of Shiva. And he was going to Varanasi for many, many years, worshipping Shiva very seriously, like really seriously he was going. And his main reason why he's worshipping Shiva is because he was extremely poor and he wanted to gain wealth. And after many, many years, and this all was happening 400 or 500 years ago, after many, many years, the Shiva came in his dream and telling him, okay, you worship me enough, now it's time that I give you your award. You will find your wealth if you go to Vrindavan. You have to meet a person named Sanatan. Sanatan Goswami. He lives under the tree. And ask him and he will share his wealth with you. Of course, Mr. Chakravarti, next morning when he wake up, the first thing what he did was to prepare to pack and to go to Vrindavan. He was traveling, he arrived in Vrindavan, and it was not that hard to find Sanatan Goswami. He was going around asking, they told that Sanatan Goswami is under the tree, he was in very deep meditation, and he patiently sit next to Sanatan Goswami, waiting him to finish his daily duties. Sanatan Goswami, one moment, got disturbed, and he opened his eyes and he saw Chakravarti sitting next to him. In the meantime, this poor person, he was looking into Sanatan Goswami, seeing his dress. I mean, dress of Sanatan Goswami was very, you know, it's like old dress. He was all dirty of Vrindavan dust. And he was not really a person who looks like somebody who has the biggest wealth of this world. He actually looked even more poor than himself. And he had a doubt, you know, is it really the person who can give me my wealth? I'm not sure about that. And then when Sanatan Goswami came to the consciousness, he was asking Chakravarti, okay, so what do you want? He said, well, I came... Shiva sent me to you and he told me that you will give me my wealth. So it's basically that you will share your wealth with me. And I came to take it as a word that I was worshiping him for many, many years. And Sanatana Goswami was looking at him and telling him, look, I don't possess any wealth. I mean, I'm the one who goes around from house to house begging for my meal, begging for even just the basic necessities. How a person such as me can give you something like that? And of course, the Chakravarti was expecting such answer, so he was very disappointed. He was thinking, okay, this was some speculation, maybe Shiva in my dream was not the real Shiva or something. You know, he turned back and started leaving that place. But then Sanatana Goswami was thinking, okay, since the Lord Shiva sent that person to me, there's probably something. Let me check. So he sent one servant, go and ask him to come back. So that person went, he asked Chakravarti to come back, and then he was telling, look, if you really want material wealth, you see that pile of garbage there? He said, yes. Well, if you dig a little bit, you know, just left and right, dig a little bit, you will find there is one stone, they call it the touchstone. You can get it there. And that will give you all your wealth. And then Chakravarti eyes was blink. He went there. It doesn't matter, it was garbage. That's fine. Touchstone is there. No matter. He started digging. One moment it was cluck. Something, you know, hard was there. He took out, it was a touchstone. He was so happy. He said, I'm going back to my West Bengal. I'm going back to Benares district. I'm going to my village. And you know, if that's really happened, now today Bengal probably will be the richest place in the world. We'll have all opulence. And you know, he started leaving the place. But then how he was leaving, in one moment he stopped and something clicked into his mind. He said, wait a minute. That's Sanatan. You see, if this is the biggest treasure of this world, why he didn't take it? Why he throw it in the garbage? This guy, he's hiding something. I need to go back to see what he's hiding from me. So he decided to go back. And he asked Sanatan Goswami, you know, this is the biggest, right? He said, yeah, it's the biggest material wealth. Yeah. He said, so why are you throwing the garbage? Why are you not using it? And Sanatan Goswami said, well, and then Chakravarti was watching him. Are you hiding something from me? Do you have something what is higher than this? Do you have some bigger wealth? I know. Shiva told me you will give me your biggest wealth, not this. And he said, okay, but let us make a deal. And he said, okay. He said, if you want me to discover you and to give you my biggest wealth, you need to take this touchstone and to go and to throw it in Jamuna River so that you will never find again. And then once you do that, because I don't want you to change your mind later, then you come back to me and sit and I will share my wealth with you. So Chakravarti in one moment was thinking, it's a touchstone, you know, it's a philosopher's stone, it's not. But then he decided, of course, I want more than that. So he went, he threw the stone in Yamuna with heart. By the way, the touchstone is still there for those who wants to take it. It's in Yamuna, actually. You know, so he came back, he sit next to Sanatan Goswami, and he was telling, okay, I'm ready. Share your wealth with me. So Sanatan Goswami was telling, okay, you're qualified now. You throw away what is the biggest material value, and now you can go higher. You're qualified. So the biggest wealth of this world is actually Golokena Prema Dharma Harinama Sankirtan, chanting of the holy names of the Lord. In the first moment, Chakravarti felt cheated. But then, with full heart actually, because his biggest treasure in that moment was actually association of Sanatan Goswami, he accepted the Sanatan Dharma, he started chanting, and he became a great, great devotee of Krishna. And this is how he really got the biggest treasure of this world. Much, much bigger than some stones, gold, whatever. And this is a very, very nice story trying to explain us where material wealth and power properties is standing comparing with the spiritual ones. It's very hard to compare that. I mean, the biggest wealth, Sanatan Goswami just throwing the garbage because he has the higher taste. And he wanted to teach us also. So he further explains that our only property in life, it has to be actually the lotus feet of Krishna and Radha. This is our only property, only what we're supposed to have in our life. Everything else is just maintenance. But property is that. Everything else belongs to Krishna. Now, how we should accept the honor message of our spiritual master? There is the right path, the right way to accept the knowledge. One way, of course, we just go directly, straight to books, da-da-da-da-da, and try. But the right way, the right channel is Guru Parampara. This is the safest way. This is probably the only way which really we can achieve the highest energy, the highest goals, through Guru Parampara. To be able to gain that knowledge properly, we need to respect the Guru Parampara and all of them who are inside in our line of successors on the right way, and to accept message which they're delivering to us on the right way, and we'll discuss what is the right way for that, and to deliver that message further also on the right way. If we're doing it in the wrong way, something wrong can happen with our spiritual life. So we have to be very careful and to know what is that right way. There is a story from my personal life. It's very short. I will share with you. 2006 or 7, I was traveling with my spiritual master, Vijay Pataka Maharaj, and I was our secretary. We went to Patna, and there was a big festival. There was Ananta Shesh ceremony, and we stayed there for a few days. So the point is that I was personal servant I supposed to take care about, and I was the only one that time. It was not like several devotees traveling and everything. It was only one, and it was very nice and very beautiful. And we went there, and the evening came. We had a very simple accommodation. There was a temple at that time. It was very simple. There was one small old house, and we had two rooms. And I was sleeping in one room, Guru Maharaj in another room. And I stayed with some devotees. We were talking later. Guru Maharaj already went to sleep. And in one moment, when I came to lie down, I entered to check if everything is okay with him in the room. So I saw the scene. I opened the door. It was quite dark. It was one small light. Guru Maharaj was sleeping on the floor. There was just one small, teeny, how you call it, something they put down there, asana or something. And he was fully covered by his chador, from the bottom to the top. You know, those long chadors, sorry. From the bottom to the top, and on the top of him was fan, in the biggest speed. And he was sleeping like that. So me, as a great servant of his spiritual master, I was thinking, okay, look at this scene. My spiritual master is suffering. Probably he feels cold. It was like November, December. He feels cold, and because of this fan which is driving him so crazy, and he put chador around himself just to get a little bit hotter. So what I did as a nice, good disciple, I turned fan off, and I went to sleep. And around 1:30, 2 a.m., somebody's waking me up on very strong way. It was Guru Maharaj. He asked me, did you turn my fan off? I said, yes, Guru Maharaj. Why? I said, because you felt cold. You close yourself, you know, with that chador. He said, no, there was a lot of mosquitoes. That's why I turned the fan off, to get them away and I put chador around myself. And look at this. There was a spots of mosquitoes around. And I was like, oh my God. You know, sometimes we cannot understand some things. If you are trying to speculate ourselves, if you are trying to understand our own way, maybe we'll make a mistake. That's why we have to be careful with every message, with everything what we read in the Shastras. We have to be careful. We have to go a little bit deeper. We cannot just use Srila Prabhupada quotes. Okay, Srila Prabhupada one time somewhere in the South America said this. We need to check more, further, to see situations, to check deeper, to go deeper into the subject. And then we will find out the answer. There is the last story that I want to share with you today is about one spiritual master who went to visit his disciple. And his disciple was trying to be nice, but he was very much on his own false ego. He was very much into level of his own speculations. He believes that he really knows a lot. He believes that he knows Shastra, his spiritual master and everything. And then he wanted to please on the perfect way his spiritual master. So he said, okay, my dear spiritual master, what do you want? And his spiritual master said, okay, I would like to eat some prasadam, if you don't mind. And then the disciple, he brought him prasadam, but then after prasadam, he brought him haritaki. You know haritaki? This is one kind of fruit, and it's very good for digestion. And there is specific way how you eat haritaki. But disciple, he just heard, he wanted to please his spiritual master, so he just heard about haritaki, so he served the full haritaki on the plate. And then spiritual master told him, okay, thank you. Can you please remove all important parts from haritaki and just bring me all unimportant, just bring me what is important and I will accept it. And then disciple was thinking, okay, usually the most important things lying in the middle. So I will remove around things and I will bring the middle and my spiritual master will be happy. When he brought him that middle, spiritual master was saying, why you remove the most important part of haritaki? It's that skin around, actually. This is the most important thing for digestion, and you just cut it, you remove it. And he was, oh, sorry, my spiritual master, I'm so sorry. And then next morning, he asked after the breakfast, his spiritual master, can I serve you something else? And he said, yeah, please bring me some cardamom. You know cardamom? It's also very good for digestion. And he was, disciple was going, and he was thinking, okay, this is cardamom. So now my spiritual master told me that I have to remove the middle and to keep what is around. So he did like that with cardamom. He removed the middle part and he kept what is around and he brought to his spiritual master. And spiritual master was looking at that and he asking, what is this? He said, my dear guru, I did what you told me. I remove middle, I kept your side, so this is the best part. He said, cardamom is different. In cardamom, the middle part is most important and skin is not important, you just have to remove it. So basically, he gave the mercy to his disciple because he was actually one big speculator. And it's not everything black and white. We cannot just take one thing and to apply it to everything. Time, place, circumstances. We have to be very careful how we use that. And that carefulness is actually a reflection of our respect toward Srila Prabhupada and his message and his books. And we should not just throw statements without deeper understanding and deeper checking, and especially without checking with our spiritual masters if they're still present on this planet. You know, we should be just humble and just try to understand on the level of deep spiritual level, not just the level of intelligence. So, I want to finish here. Basically, the conclusion of today should be probably that we have to go all to the wealth of Harinam Sankirtan, of chanting the holy name of the Lord, and to stay there, and to go everywhere. And we are on the right place in the Sri Dhama Mayapur. And I want to ask you to chant one time Hare Krishna Mantra with me together. Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Ram, 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 Hare Hare. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Sanatan Goswami ki jai. Gaura Premanande, Hare Hare Bol. Hare Krishna. If there is comment or question, okay, but otherwise it's already 9:10. I'm sure you have many obligations and everything. Yes, Mataji. Is there a mic? Thank you very much for being here today. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. I'm still trying to understand for the question where can we understand everything? I couldn't get the answer for that. Maybe I missed it.
Right. Well, the answer for that was actually that story about the frog in the well. Although I didn't mention on the end when I was preparing to mention that, but I was watching that watch all the time, and they wrote here we have to finish until 9. So I was trying to cut. But the point is actually that we are always trying to understand everything from our small perspective. You know, our life is, we are just one of millions and billions beings around, human beings. There are many, many millions, billions, right? 8.5 billion just on this planet. And we are on the one very small planet. And we are one of the smallest universes. And, you know, this is part of material world. And the point is that we are always trying everything to understand from our own perception. And it's not that we always can understand everything. What is happening in spiritual world, what is happening in Brahmajyoti, what is happening in all planets, all higher planets, to understand all demigods, to understand all different dimensions, not just our three, but another 5, 6, 7, 10, 12, 15. You know, this is same like that, you know, you find the ant and you want to teach him what is the quantum physics. How to do that? He doesn't have the right computer, let's say, for that. It's very, I mean, on our level we can understand something, we can grab the surface. But it's very hard to understand all aspects to be able to understand the absolute truth. So we can accept knowledge, and that's why the safest thing is just whatever we receive in the same package to transfer further, not to add more. You know, somebody is cooking something, then bring us preparation, then we said, okay, let me put more masala inside, or let me put more salt or different things, I know better. You know, that's why we should not go so much into digging. You know, we should accept message and transfer it as it is in the right. And also, if we don't understand something, doesn't mean that we have to understand on material level, on the platform of the pure material intelligence. The spiritual intelligence is actually guru sadhu shastra. The spiritual intelligence, if we don't understand something, we ask guru. If guru is not present, we ask sadhu. If we cannot find sadhu, we go to shastra and try really seriously to check deeper. For example, you know, I was researching about cruelty just a few days, you know, before this class. And I went to Wikipedia and I checked cruel. And the word cruel came out so many, it was 1,600 something, you know, different statements in different books about cruelty. And interesting thing is that different verses are talking about different aspects and different situations. So therefore, instead of making the general opinion about something just by reading one statement, we need to check to avoid that same situation like that disciple, you know, in one situation, Haritaki, he did the wrong thing, so he did again wrong thing just because he applied the rule which is just for Haritaki, it's not for another situation, it's not for Kardama. So that was actually the point, that we should accept knowledge, we should gain the knowledge, but sometimes we cannot understand everything. Like they have a big discussion in Europe right now, whether we came down from spiritual world or we never been there. That's the biggest thing at the moment. it's a top. And I will not go into that, please. No. The point is that you know, we need some time just to accept, and since we are this Guru Parampara, we should accept what Srila Prabhupada said about that. We should respect Srila Prabhupada in that way. Not to go further, to dig deeper, to go, you know, because it's very hard for us to understand Brahman, spiritual world, you know, all these aspects, because we didn't saw that. The frog didn't saw the ocean. So she could not have even perception. You can imagine somebody is born blind. How to explain him how all this looks? It's very hard. Try blind person who is born blind to explain, okay, what is the white color? Or green color, or red color, or what is the shape of the heart. He can touch a little bit, you know. So in that level, in that way, we are quite blind, and it's very hard to understand everything. So that's my understanding of that subject. Thank you very much for question. Okay, thank you. Hare Krishna. Dhanyavad.